Hello?
To the collect call from
Life of a Lifer.
To accept this call, press 5 now.
Hello, friends and family. How you doing today? Hopefully everything's going well. Just another day in the slammer. Thank you for joining us, though. Let's go ahead and get into this interview. We got Sara Bennett, who is a pretty amazing woman, all the way from New York. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
All right. From what I understand, I keep hearing a lot of great things about this Life After Life in Prison website that you started and this project that you've been working on with a bunch of women that are lifers in prison or after they've gotten out of prison?
Right, both.
Okay, so would you like to tell us about it? Because it sounds quite interesting to me.
Yeah, so I'm a former criminal defense attorney. I was a defense attorney for like 18 years, and I left the practice of law in 2006. And then around 2008, 2009, I picked up a pro bono case where I was trying to get clemency from the governor of New York for a woman who had a 75-year-to-life sentence. Somewhere along the line, like maybe 2 or 3 years later, I was trying to figure out how to make her feel more real than she was just on paper. So I ended up photographing 15 women who had been incarcerated with her, who had come out talking about her influence on them. I wasn't really a photographer then. It was just an advocacy project. I put it together in a little book. It's called Spirit on the Inside. I started sending it around to the state legislators, the governor, pretty much anybody I could think of who might be able to have an impact on getting her clemency. So fast forward a few more years and she actually did get clemency. But what that project did for me was it set me on this photography road of trying to humanize people who had life sentences. Because when people looked at the book I had done for her, they were really curious about the women's lives. Oh, she was in prison. What was she in prison for? She's so beautiful. She has a child. Oh, she's a grandmother. I just felt like people out in the world were not that attuned to what people went to prison for, what their lives were like, or anything like that. So that's what got me started. In the back of my mind, I always wanted to photograph women in prison with life sentences. But I didn't know how to get that access. And so I started out by following 4 women through their reentry process. So they all had life sentences, but not life without parole. They had, say, 25 to life and then ended up being denied parole many times into 35 years. So that's my first project. It's called Life After Life in Prison. It now has 7 women in it. But when I first started showing around and exhibiting it, it followed the reentry of 4 women. And at that time, when it was exhibited, maybe I'd been following them for about 16 months, but now it's a long-term project. I've been following the same women for 5 or 6 years. So that's kind of how I got started. The reason I did lifers is because, you have to look back, this is like 2012. People were not actually talking that much about mass incarceration yet, but when they were talking about the low-level drug offenders. And you could start to see that. That was what Obama was doing. And they were setting up those commissions to look at low-level drug offenders. In my mind, I was like, but what about the lifers? Like, those are the people who are filling up our prisons. If we're going to do something about incarceration, we really, really have to look at why we send people away for decades or even life. And I want people to meet the people that I know through photography or whatever and feel for them. So that's how I got started. My second project, which is the one that your wife came to in Portland, is called the Bedroom Project. It now has 21 women in it, and it's 21 women who had life sentences who then came home, and they're sitting in their bedrooms. I took portraits of them in their bedrooms because that's a very intimate space and often the only space they have because they may live in shelters or communal housing, but it's their own space. And then I ask them to write something about how they felt in that space. So that's the second one. And then the third one is called Looking Inside, Portraits of Women Serving Life Sentences. And that one I did basically in 2018, 2019, and I photographed 20 women with life sentences inside either a maximum security prison or if they were at the end of their sentences, they were in a medium. And again, I asked them what they wanted to tell the outside world. So that's what I'm doing. Through my visual imagery, I'm trying to get people to think about the humanity of people behind bars or out in the world.
Yeah, that was very articulated into a way that gave me a lot of insight, because the points that you're making about humanizing people serving life sentences, and it sounds like you're kind of a pioneer as far as giving a voice and a picture so people can look inside to see more than just, oh, this person committed this horrible crime and now let's cast them away from society forever and act like they're not alive anymore, act like they're not still people.
I want people to also understand, because I was a lawyer, I'm sort of uniquely placed to bring my own understanding of the system out into the public, like it's kind of a melding of an artistic viewpoint with a legal viewpoint. I'll actually send you a copy of my newest book called Looking Inside, Portraits of Women Serving Life Sentences. But when they're up on the wall and people look at it and they're like, oh, that woman has life without parole. I wonder what she did. And I can say what she did is no different than the person standing next to her who has 20 to life. It's just the arbitrariness of the system. It's a matter of who your defender was or who the judge was or what county you were sentenced in or what was happening in that town at that moment. There's just so many things that go into it, but it's not because one person's act is any worse than the other person. I just want people to think about that. But mostly what I really want people to think about is toll on us as a society when we treat people so poorly and we lock them up. My project is all women. It's because mostly people focus on men in the system and they don't really think that much about women. But I met so many amazing women, some of whom have done really horrible things. It doesn't mean they're horrible people. They're actually really interesting people who we all could learn an awful lot from, right? So maybe they were victims of circumstances, or maybe, who knows? Honestly, I'm not really that interested in what took people to prison. Not what took them there, because I'm really interested in people's backstories. But I'm not that interested in the particular act that locked them away for decades. I feel like we focus way too much for the rest of people's criminal histories or whatever on that one act. And we never really seem to see beyond it. And it's the not being able to see beyond it that makes us give people life sentences.
People end up getting defined by that, and then the only thing that people ever say about it is that, and they don't look any further into that person or their life, and then they just all of a sudden, that's it, and then you're gone. And it seems the system is set up to focus on punishment instead of rehabilitation. And also, through the 14 years I've been incarcerated, I've noticed that a lot of lifers take it upon themselves, even though most of the programming is not available to lifers, just due to the fact that they say, well, you're doing life in prison, so why do we need to take any of our resources to do anything with you guys? Because you're just going to be in here forever anyway, so we don't need to waste our money or time on that. However, I've noticed that a lot of lifers take it upon themselves at some point to get involved in whatever volunteer programs that they can and then end up becoming like really positive influences on the other people that come into prison and try to make a difference to where these people don't keep coming back to prison and are teaching some of these programs now.
Yeah, exactly.
I believe people can change and people can be rehabilitated. There should be like some type of redemption available to people that were not just wasting not only taxpayer dollars and money that's put into housing people, because I mean, it costs a lot of money to house somebody. So if you were to put that same money into rehabilitating somebody and then they were able to get out and be a productive member of society and also have an influence on the next generation to not make the same mistakes, that I think it would make a lot more sense.
Well, like, I also think we talk a lot about rehabilitation and change, but honestly, I feel like people sometimes are who they are at their core. It's just that as a society, we fail people when they're young. And so they don't get the chance to realize who they actually could be. And then sadly, people go to prison and then they get an education and then they're in a safe place, or safe, I have to put quotation marks around it, but especially for a lot of people who experience a lot of violence in their lives on the outside, if they're in a prison where they're not experiencing a lot of violence and it can be a safer place, they get to be who they were. Like, it's sad that you...
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. First
place,
yeah.
That's the first place you get an education, and then people say, oh, we rehabilitated them. But I say, what if you had taken that child from the time they were 5 years old and you put them in real good schools and they had the proper support and their family had the support and they had enough to eat and they had a place to live? People would not be resorting to violence, right? And then that's what you see in people who've been in prison a long time. You see them as their best selves because they've had that opportunity to become that. So that's the first time I'm saying that, because I'm always hearing people are always talking about rehabilitation, and I always feel like when I get to know people and you ask them about their childhood, if they're an artist, they were always an artist. They just didn't have the chance to do that. Or if they like to read, they did like to read. They just didn't have access to the books, or there was something chaotic going on at home or something like that.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, absolutely. And I guess I say rehabilitation because that is something that you hear a lot of and people relate to.
Right, of course.
Right, yeah. But I understand exactly what you're saying. More than just that, when you look into it on a deeper level, because I was very young when I was arrested. I was 20 years old, and a few years before that, I had just came out of a pretty horrible place that I got sent to when I was 15 until I was nearly 17. I went to this place called Tranquility Bay. There's a documentary about it out there, but long story short, they shut them down because they said that they were basically torturing kids. I went through a lot of horrible stuff, and then shortly after that, I started doing a lot of drugs, which led me to that lifestyle. Though I'm not guilty of the crime that they found me guilty of, I did a lot of bad stuff leading up to there, so I don't blame anybody for winding up in the situation that I'm in, and I take responsibility for everything that I have done. But it just shows that after time of like 5 or 6, 7 years of being in prison and coming to take accountability and really like become a man instead of the kid that I was, and the things that I went through up until that point was when I started to come into being a good person. And it's just thrived ever since.
The universal story of people in prison, right, is that something happened to you that set you on a path that was not a good path. But if you had had the proper support and intervention, you wouldn't have found yourself in that situation in the first place. That's just what I'm trying to say, right? And I think that's true for most people. Unless there's like mental illness, really a lot of prisons are filled with people with severe mental illness that is untreated or something like that. And then on occasion, there are a few people who probably do fit into the category of psychopaths, but there's not that many.
Yeah, and I know
there's
some people that I wouldn't say that people don't deserve to get out of prison, but maybe need like that psychiatric treatment versus a prison treatment where you just get locked in a box.
Exactly.
And they may not be fit for society, but yet there is a great deal of people that are. But in Washington State, we came up with the numbers that there's like 1,300 people that'll never get out of prison the way that the system stands right now. And I know... Mm-hmm. A lot of people that are part of that 1,300 that are great, great people. They've
right, and honestly, that's what I'm trying to show through my photography. There's a lot of people, and the nice thing about working in a visual medium is you look at people, and you can see something when you look at a photo of somebody, and then you read what they have to say. It makes them a real person for you, and people feel a lot of compassion and empathy for my portrait subject. And I know that because I've exhibited in this place. It's called Photoville. It's in Brooklyn, and it's once a year. And over the course of 8 days, they say 100,000 people pass through there. And they set up a little city almost built out of freight containers. And so I had a freight container last year with the bedroom project, and this year with the women inside prison. And people came through there, and I talked to people nonstop for like 8 to 10 hours every day for 8 days. And people would go in and they would spend a lot of time like looking at the photos and reading what the woman had to say. And then they would come out and they would be crying. And I always have a formerly incarcerated woman lifer with me so that they could talk to somebody who had actually had that experience. And then I had a place where people could write to the women who were in prison. And like there was a lot of, first of all, ignorance about what we do as a society. And then there was so much compassion that was coming from the viewers towards the women. And I thought, well, this is successful. This is what I'm trying to do. And visually, it's a nice way to do it.
Yeah, because reading something about somebody that somebody writes or something like that is one thing, but actually seeing people, and not just in their worst light, like a lot of people get painted out to be bad, and any images that get put out to the public are like behind bars or something in a courtroom, handcuffed, things like that.
Mug
but
shots,
when you actually, yeah, mugshots, stuff like that. But when you actually get to see somebody as a person and humanize that person, like what you're doing with your projects that you got going on, it's really cool. It's like, it's actually getting to see that person as a person. And the fact that you're focusing on women, I think is great too. The two things, like you're doing the lifers and the women and focusing your resources on that. And I think that that's awesome because, like you were saying, there really isn't a lot of exposure for women to get painted in a realistic light and a humanized light like the way that you're doing. And so I really commend you, and I respect it a lot because it's a subject that nobody's really talking about.
Actually, people are really talking about these issues now, which is very exciting. As I told you, I was a defense lawyer and stopped in 2006, I think I said, or 2004, which means that I started in the 80s. So back then, nobody was talking about these issues. I mean, not nobody. There were a few people who were thinking about these issues. I guess probably all the defense attorneys and the families and the people who were incarcerated. But within the bigger world, nobody was thinking about mass incarceration at all. I went to an art event yesterday and somebody was doing a dance, and they were doing it to a speech by Angela Davis about abolishing prisons. That was so unexpected to me. I mean, I knew the artist. I was like, wow, this is really, really going out everywhere. And it was just really great. And I do think that we're going to see some changes. I think it's really, really important to focus on people with the lengthy sentences and the life sentences, though.
Yeah, people don't really want to address that subject. And a lot of it's politics, I think, too.
People are now caring about it and thinking about it. You're talking about doing a record, and I know somebody who's doing a record, and you have a magazine, and I know somebody else has a magazine. There's a lot of work going on. There's an art show every single year on Governor's Island in New York, and it's called Marking Time. And it makes for 6 weeks, and it shows art from that's been made by people in prison all over the country. I mean, there's just like so much stuff going on now.
Right.
It's very exciting.
I respect what you're doing 100% because
thank you.
It's something that a lot of people wouldn't touch, and you've put in so much into it. I can tell that you've like really put a lot of time and effort and energy and kind of made it. It almost seems like a life's work of yours. So.
Yeah, it kind of is, or it's become that way. I don't know. I think it's just all of my different skills and passions have come together with this project. I mean, I loved practicing criminal law. I loved being an attorney. I had a particular way of practicing that was, I think, maybe a little bit on the more creative side, but now being able to do it visually, having all the background knowledge, it's a really great way of having a platform that people can respond to. Let's put it that way. I mean, and that's the nice thing about an art gallery, right? You're drawing in people who wouldn't ordinarily be drawing in. And then they're exposed to issues that they haven't necessarily thought about. But once they're there, they learn about the issues, and then they care about them. I think that's one way of many of trying to change policy. That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of times people need to physically be there and experience it and just be able to open their mind a little bit to different
concepts. Well, it takes it from the adult. I mean, first, people who are locked up are locked away, so people don't think about them that much. And if they do, it's very abstract. And I say it has to be abstract or we wouldn't treat people the way we do. Because if people actually saw, like, how people lived inside prison and what they ate and what the work conditions were and how much they got paid and that they paid for their phone calls and they pay for their emails and they pay for everything. The living conditions that are so bad that people wouldn't put their animal in, right? But we do that to human beings because we don't see them.
Definitely wouldn't feed their animals the food we get, that's for sure.
I actually had a pop-up exhibition in one of the prisons where I exhibited. In other words, I took the exhibit to the prison where I had photographed the women, and the whole prison got to come down and see the photos. It was really awesome. But I actually was given what they call the feed-up tray. I don't know if that's what you call it. I got to experience what the food was. It's a little bit hard to describe. I mean, I'm a long way away from the lunch that you used to get in school, but I think the lunch in school probably looks better than whatever it is that you guys are getting.
To say the least. I think it's amazing what you're doing, and I definitely appreciate you coming on here and talking to me and sharing what it is that you're doing. That was really cool that you've been traveling all over the place with this show that you're exhibiting. I know my wife said that she had a great time there and that it was very eye-opening and riveting, kind of the way that you've displayed what you're doing.
I haven't really traveled. The work has been, actually, it was in Croatia and it's been in India. So it's been around the world, but I have not been around the world with it. This is the first time I went outside of New York to an exhibition, but it was really fun. And it was really great to meet your wife and to meet the other family members I met of yours and your supporters. You have a really strong support network, and that was really nice to see.
Well, yeah, I'm fortunate for that. And the more people hear and actually stop to listen to the story, the more people get to see what I've been able to accomplish, the more the support that I've been able to get. Because when they check it out and they really take the time to see what it is that you're about, it's like, wow, I support that. This guy does deserve
another chance.
Exactly,
because they see you as a real person with real interests and real talents and skills and abilities.
Hey, that was so awesome. I really appreciate Sarah. She's a pretty amazing lady, and I really enjoy what she's doing. I think that it's something that's powerful and meaningful. Really, there's not a lot of people that are looking out for the women like that, and especially the lifers. The lifers, men or women, are a lost and forgotten about group of individuals that get cast away from society, and Sarah's really shining some light on that. She's taken her show on the road all the way from New York. She came out to the West Coast just recently and was doing a gallery exhibit about the artwork that she's doing and the stories of the women that she's representing, and I think it's just a beautiful thing. I do appreciate you coming out to listen today, and check out designconviction.com, check out freetailorproject.com, and don't forget to hit us on Instagram at A Life of a Lifer. Send us your questions, comments, any feedback that you may have, and we will get back to you. All right. Have a good day. Thank you for listening. I'm Taylor Conley, and this is Life of a Lifer podcast. Be sure to visit the website lifeofalifer.com, and don't forget to subscribe so you never miss an episode.